Today is May 4th, 2005. We're in Rushmore, which is in Walnut Creek, California. We're interviewing Jarkiewicz.
Very good.
My name is Peter Ryan, interviewer, and Brent Saldinger is doing the videotaping. Could I ask where and when you were born?
I was born in Bentlevo, very small village in Lipno County, about 80 miles northwest from Warsaw.
Northwest,
roughly, yeah.
And how many were in your family?
Well, in my family there was my father, of course, my mother.
Can you give the name?
Yes, my father was Zdzislaw Jarkiewicz, and my mother was Bronisława Wilczyński. I had older brother, seven years older, Zygmunt. And then I had sister, Stanisława, who was about 3 years older than I, and younger, Irena and Helena. So there were five of us siblings.
And you were the third?
Yeah, yes, I was the third, you're right.
Okay. And what did your father do?
My father was chief of the police in the in that place where I was born. Then he was transferred many other locations. So I remember the first things which I remember when I was small, maybe 3-4 years old, that my father was always in uniform. I will show a picture later. And he was very tall. And he didn't have much time for me because he was always on duty and so on. In addition, he, before the First World War, he was drafted in the Russian army. Why Russian? Because the Poland didn't exist on the map. It was partitioned by Russia, Prussia, and Austria. So I got his picture in Russian uniform, which I can show you later, I found in Boston with my aunt. And so it was taken in 1910. What happened that my father, and he was assigned to the Tsar bodyguard, Przebrzeżański Pełn, because they were selecting very tall guys and so on. So my father served over there. However, during revolution in 1917-18, he escaped to Poland. Of course, they were very, very easy to escape because Reds were fighting Whites, Bolsheviks, and so on. So I heard this story only from my aunt in Boston, his sister. She said that he was traveling at night and whenever he could to avoid any groups, whether Whites or Blacks. And usually he summer went to the garden and slept during daytime. And my grandfather, Wilczyński, he said, Bronia, to my mother, go to the, bring some, you know, vegetables from the garden. And she went and there was a soldier, Russian uniform. So she gets panicky, but he stopped her, said, I'm not Russian, I'm Polish. So suddenly they develop, you know, and my brother was born. In 1918.
In the garden.
Not in the garden, but I was born. But my father, when he was born, he left. It was in Wołynia district, which was the eastern part of Poland. So what happened? My father went to the central of Poland. That's where he came from. And my mother had five brothers. And they were kind of furious. There was a soldier, there's a baby, and he left. So finally my father joined the Polish police in 1919, 1 year after the First World War. And they brought my mother and my brother to Central Poland. What happened? First World War ended in 1918. And so everybody was happy. Western countries, Poland, because we gained our independence until 123 years. And so, but everything wasn't so rosy. What happened? Bolsheviks, communists won in Russia, and they wanted to expand. So at that time, there was a lot of dissatisfaction. In Germany, they lost the war, Hungarians, and there was very strong communist party in Germany. So they wanted to march through Poland to the rest of Europe, what they've done in Second World War. They wanted to expand. And they were appealing to Polish working class, you know, because working class, usually they want to change from the capitalistic system. But we are oppressed for 123 years. We had two uprisings against Russia. So finally, Poland, with help from the Polish army, general army organized in Canada and other, somehow we managed to defeat the Russian army at Warsaw. And once they were defeated, then Poland, that was took in 1920. At that time, my father, there's Wrocławek, about 24 kilometers from that place where I was born, but on other side of Vistula. So in order, on the left side of Vistula, there was Polish army, on the right, Russians already took that place. So my father was defending at the bridge, which was acting destroyed at that time. And I remember he had medal for his meritorious service in the Polish forces, and also for the battle in 1920. That's what I remember. Then we were transferred, because there was such a policy that policeman, chief of police, was for a few years in one place, another place, and so on.
Was he always the chief of police wherever?
Yes, he was always chief of police.
Okay.
And then in Chernikovo, that's a village which I remember distinctly, because I started to go to the grade school. I was 6.5 years old. And of course for me there was some big, you know, something before the war in Poland, that I could go to school, I had to, you know, start like every children. Quite often I was happy boy, but we didn't have any electricity, there was no radio, no cars, I never saw a car in my life, you know. We had only kerosene lamp. Quite often I was running barefoot playing Polish baseball. Actually, we call it paland. It's not so complicated like in the United States baseball, but you know, it is. And next to us was Jewish tailor, and quite often with that, his son, I was 6.5, he was about my age, we're holding hand, going to school, coming back. And I remember on Saturday, we were playing, you know, paland, but that poor boy had to pray. His father was Orthodox Jews, and we were sorry for him, but, you know, that's I remember. Mm-hmm. Then you were transferred to another place, Dobrzyń nad Wisłą, that's the name, then to Wielgie Miodusy, and in that place I met a good friend of mine, who was going to the same class with me. But then I realized how Poland was a poor country. He never drank tea in his life. So when I invited him to my house, he was bragging about that he had tea. So he had only a small little house. There was not even kerosene, because they couldn't afford. But I like to go to their, you know, home, because in the evening they were sitting, they had like cast iron oven, they made Polish pancakes from potatoes, and they were so tasty to me at that time, and so on.
You loved it, huh?
Yeah, lovely. And at that time, you know, I was happy, and nobody thought, I didn't know anything. And I remember I used to go to the grave of my grandfather, who died in 1922. And I got still letter here when my 1922, my father sent to Boston to notify his sisters, my aunts, about death of my grandfather. So everything was so nice and dandy. Finally, we moved to
Did you know your grandfather?
Pardon?
Did you know him, your grandfather?
No, never met him.
He died before you were born?
Yeah, he died in 1922, and I was born in 1925.
Okay.
And fortunately, we found his picture now. I never saw even his picture, but I got his picture now. And we moved to county town, which was Lipno. And then my father was chief of police. And in Lipno, in that town, there was a lot of Jewish merchants, but there was a lot of German minorities. Germans were born in Poland, who grew up in Poland. And generally, the relations were pretty good among them, these Germans and so on. And I started to go to high school. In high school in Poland, before the war, not everybody could afford. My father had to pay for it. So the poor people couldn't afford to go to high school.
So their education stopped at that point?
Yes, mostly for most of the people. Uh-huh. But my father, because he was on the state employee, he got like 50% discount. So my brother first started to go to that, and he was going to graduate in 1938. I entered, you know, to that high school. So everything worked perfect. Now, in 1938, there's a lot of things changed in Europe. I was 13, 12 years old, you know, at that time. And I remember that Hitler came to power in 1933. Then I think I vaguely remember he wanted to take Austria, and Mussolini was opposing at first. But later, when there was no response from England and France, he supported Hitler, and Hitler took Austria without any fight. And I remember there was one elderly fellow, and he said, they took their country and they welcomed Hitler with flowers. You know, Austrians, I couldn't understand that at that time. So then, in 1938, there was Czechoslovakian crisis. What happened? When Hitler got, you know, Austria without fighting, before he occupied in the western part, close to France, which, you know, there was a demilitarized zone, in 36, and there was no response from England or from France. So he was very bold. What about Czechoslovakia? And Czechoslovakia, remember, the mobilized army. But in Czechoslovakia, there was about 3 million German minorities. And of course, when Hitler came to power, they have their own guys trained who came to Czechoslovakia, even to Poland, which later became the Fifth Column. They were Polish citizens, like in Czechoslovakia, like even in this country, you have Hitler organizations, you know. And so what happened? There was a meeting in Munich when there was Daladier, Chamberlain, Mussolini, and Hitler. In order to have save the peace, they sacrificed Czechoslovakia. They gave okay to Hitler to take Sudetenland. And what happened? In that Sudetenland, the Czech had fortifications. So they were simply betrayed by the Allies, who wanted to have peace at any cost. And then later, Hitler took the whole Czechoslovakia.
Were you interested in these events at the
Yes,
time?
Because I was interested because sometimes my father told me about fighting against Russians mostly, against Germans. So I always overheard. He didn't tell me directly, but we were discussing, you know, like father with his friends and so on. So that's why I became interested. In addition, Polish press was printing those events. And my friend had a radio. We didn't have any radio. So I heard about this what was going on at that time. Mm-hmm. And then...
Was, as a teenager or as a child, was it hard for you to move around to different towns?
Actually, it wasn't. I mean, usually you have to adjust new friends, but when you are young, you very quickly adjust yourself. When you are old, that's a different story. But when you're young, I always make friends. I didn't have many friends, but only few very good friends.
Did you like school?
Yes, I liked school. However, I was not very good student. I was like a C, you know, student, not any. Point that Polish high school is much higher level than in this country. My brother, we had to take Greek, Latin, and one modern language, French or German. So I took German, and my brother took German, which later helped him in concentration camp because he knew German. That's a different story now. So suddenly Hitler put a pressure on Poland, because I got the map some over there, because Poland was created after the First World War. And we have access to Danzig, to the Baltic Sea harbor. That's what he wanted. And President Wilson, one of his points, 13 points, wanted after the First World War that Poland should have access to Baltic. Now, in other words, to the west of that were Germany, and at Baltic, it was enclave Prussia, which was part of Germany, except we cut that in half. Hitler called that corridor. So he put pressure now, when he took Austria and Czechoslovakia, he put pressure on Polish to give him that special passage, extraterritorial, passage, and some other demands. And he wanted to incorporate Danzig to Germany. And of course, we had example, Austria, Sudetenland, Czechoslovakia. Now we know once he takes that, then Poland is,
You know what's coming.
It's what's coming. They didn't know what to do. So, but at that time, everybody, the whole countries were very much afraid of Germany. They knew they were powerful. Nobody wanted to risk. But we had military agreement with France. Now England, now they realize that in order to stop the Hitler, we have to do something. So they assure Polish government that in case of the invasion by Hitler, that England and France will come to our help. But to the east, we have very powerful Russia or Soviet Union. But we had a pact in 1932, non-aggression pact with Russia, in 1934 with Hitler, non-aggression pact. But when Hitler put pressure and Polish government said no, so he renounced our, agreement in 1934, and they started propaganda, how we treat German minorities in Poland, how we persecute them. In the meantime, the Germans who were Polish citizens were going to Germany and trained quite often, just in case of war, they formed the fifth column, who were acting behind Polish lines. That was the whole idea. And I remember that on the September 1st, 1939, my brother was 21 years old and he was in 14th Polish regiment in the army. And my mother said, why don't I make a cake and you on bicycle go to visit and bring him that cake? I didn't realize that was the beginning of war. So about 10 o'clock I was approaching that Wrocławek, that place where he was stationed. And one lady said, oh my God, they are fighting. I realized that something terrible happened, but I didn't know what it was. Then I was driving further, and then one guy motorcycle stopped And he brought some shrapnels from German, you know, shells, and said, I just came from the, you know, they're fighting on the front line. So I visited my friend, and that was first of the, and there was a bridge across Vistula River in that place. And I saw two German planes were coming, but Polish artillery were shooting at them. Of course, they didn't shoot them down, but they were shooting, but didn't approach bridge too close because of artillery. Then I went back home to Lipno. In the meantime, my father, as chief of police, practically didn't come home. They were organizing Polish auxiliary police. In addition to that, they had names of very some Germans who were very active in Poland. So they wanted to transfer them to eastern part of Poland. And what happened, we rented apartment from the German who used to teach German language in Polish high school. They were very good people, we got a relationship, everything. But his daughter was married to a German who was in a Lutheran church, in German church, he was organist or something, and he was very active. And my father had a list from the county which Germans should be transferred because just we don't want it, because they already are acting in other parts behind the German lines. So what happened? We knew that lady, we knew that guy, but they took him and were transferring him. Then my brother came from his unit to Lipno, and what happened? County issue order, anybody who got guns, rifles, or anything has to bring to the police station. And we took that, my brother registered everybody, and I put them guns on the shelf in the police station. And a lot of these guys said, what the hell are you doing? There's Germans all around us, why we should give guns, you know? But my brother said, this is the order, I don't know why, I'm just, that was stupid thing which was, but that's on the Polish, and that's what happened.
Do you know what the thinking behind that was, to gather?
Well, they didn't want anybody to have any guns, evidently, because, you know, we cannot control. Besides, we didn't have many guns like in this country, there was only a few persons. So to take, you know, what was the, I don't know, and the people were right. Why should they give guns, which they proved very costly later? But at that time, war started. People had this silly idea that would be the same like First World War, occupation, Russians go, Germans go. Nobody expected what is going to happen. So anyway, so then on the third day, German plane came and were bombing highway close to my high school. There was viaduct, but somehow they didn't hit that. And there was big clouds of smoke. I thought they were going to use gas, because during First World War they were using gas on the Western Front. I remember my father had special mask, but the rest of people didn't have any mask. And that was until fifth day of war, September 5th, Germans were approaching our town. And what happened? My father decided that, and my mother had been decided, my mother should go to eastern part of Poland, because my mother had, that's where my mother came from, she had brothers and so on. My father had to stay behind, so we drove with the Polish army, and we are going to meet in Volhynia district, in the eastern part of Poland. That was the whole idea. So on the 5th of...
Were the children to go with the mother?
Yeah, no, children and I, and except my brother who was in the Polish army at that time. So, we didn't have cars, we had a horse and buggies, you know, and there was about 10 or 15 these horses, mostly families of the some Polish influential citizens in that little town, police, firemen, teachers, and so on. They were sending, you know, that's what happened. But, you know, horse, they were so slow. Finally, overnight, we made across the Vistula River to Włocławek. And Włocławek was slightly bigger town than Lipno. That's where I was coming from. And I saw two German planes, and one Polish plane was attacking those two Germans. But for the Polish plane looked like a toy. Germans stepped on the gas and left him behind, you know. There was First World War or something. There was no comparison. Then we are going through the highway towards Warsaw on the other side of the Vistula River. And there was forest, and there are a lot of Polish soldiers. And my mother came and said, "There's the units who are, you know, who from the front line. You know, the units who were defeated on the front line. They're trying to gather together to defend themselves." So we were going in that direction. All highways was like a big parking space. People, civilian, army was trying to escape. You couldn't move practically.
Chaos.
Huh? Yes. So finally, so you
went. People were trying to get to the east. They felt they would be safer.
That's what we thought. But don't forget that people and myself, we remember First World War was 4 years old. I mean, lasted 4 years. And here there was the fifth, seventh day of war. Never. I mean, some people who knew what was going on, they knew that they have armored division, everything, they can move very fast. But the rest of the population, including mine, we didn't have an idea. Once they break the front line, they go like hell. If there's any resistance, they send a lot of Stuka diving bombers, everything, so they crash everything. So we were no match for them. And yet, they wouldn't capitulate. So we are going, and finally we went to one town. We wanted to buy a bread. Thousands of people at the bakery buy a bread. Prices jumped about 10 times more than before. We couldn't get anything. And so we were approaching Warsaw. But before we approached Warsaw, there was a little town, Sochaczew, on Bzura River, and there was a bridge. We were trying to get to that highway going through Sochaczew to Warsaw. Suddenly I saw three German planes going in one direction. They came back, and that time they were strafing people, dropping bombs, and so on. And I remember about 10 minutes when you entered that highway, there was car burning. I remember one girl was burning in horses were, you know, killed. And that cart was on fire. And my mother covered eyes of my sister so she couldn't look at this. Evidently, mother was still alive. Father was lying somewhere. It was a horrible picture. I mean, I was 14. We are not prepared for that.
Nobody's prepared.
Never that. So finally we made through that bridge on the square. I saw a lot of bodies. They were strafing, bombing, and so on. And then we passed that little town. We stopped our horses on the side road, and German planes were circling above us for at least half an hour. So I was lying in the potato field. I was even afraid to look at him. I was so panicky. And finally, at night, they decided not to go to Warsaw directly on highway, go to the side roads, field roads, you know, to one plane. So that's where we're going. It takes longer, but at least we are not exposed to the highway, to German planes and so on. But German artillery was a front right there. And I heard boom, shoo, boom, boom, shoo. Behind Germans were shooting, and in front of us, shells were exploding. So he finally made to the bridge. I don't remember the name, Zakrochim or some other on the bridge. And there was already Polish cavalry. They were still close to that bridge. So the horses went with the baggage went across the bridge, and we were running across that bridge on the other side of the Vistula River. So you went on the other side. Other side was comparatively peaceful. There was a lot of army soldiers going and so on. Everybody going towards the Warsaw. And then on the way there was a lot of soldiers marching. And guess, a lot of soldiers, they were marching at that time. We didn't have any lorries, cars, they were marching on foot most of the time.
The Polish soldiers?
Polish, yeah. And amazingly, there was my brother. With this daughter. So my mother saw him on the 12th day of war, and we were so happy. I remember I had a little pistol which I took with me from the police station. I gave my brother and so on, so we were so happy that he was alive. Then we came to Warsaw, and in Warsaw we saw already streetcars overturned, people digging trenches. But we didn't want to stop in Warsaw, we wanted to go to the eastern part of Poland. So on the 13th day, next day, we passed Warsaw, and then we were about maybe 10 miles
past Warsaw,
yes. And then we were going, and then I saw Polish soldiers going towards the front line, and suddenly German shells started to explode around us, and we were close to the highway. So we lie down behind one brick building. When they stopped shelling in that little woods, my mother was in many other families, and my mother said, "Children, why don't you come and I give you sandwiches?" And when I was approaching my mother, I saw German planes, about 9 German planes up there. And I don't know whether that was intuition or something, I started to run, and some other people started to run. Because I remember when they're bombing before, quite often they didn't hit the highway, just beside the highway, there was crates from bombs. So finally I stopped, I sit down, and I heard the first bomb coming down. So I lie down, open my mouth, cover my ending, and there was explosion, another explosion, another explosion. And I heard the scream of my sister, who was 17 at that time. And from this time I saw my mother, she got killed instantly. It was the
His mother.
So I ran across the road. I couldn't even approach her. There was another guy who was also. So what happened? Now, and guy who was on our wagon, he got also wounded, so another guy, and with the horses, everybody, all these, you know, wagons went towards the Warsaw. We went to Warsaw.
So you turned around?
Turned around back to Warsaw, because we couldn't go any further. There was front line.
And who was it then? You?
I was not my sister, mm-hmm. who was 17 years old. I was 14. Mm-hmm. Another was 9 years old and 7 years old. So we went back to Warsaw. Of course, that was the last escape route from Warsaw. Germans were closing the ring. They surrounded Warsaw completely. And what happened? We didn't know what was front line. I thought, but at that time we came to Warsaw, and Warsaw wouldn't capitulate. Now, Hitler, I remember they already announced, somebody told me on radio that they took Warsaw on the 8th day of war, because German armored columns broke through the Polish lines and reached one part of Warsaw, but there was such a heavy defense by Polish unit, they destroyed like 60 German tanks, because in the field, they had no match to Germans, tanks, planes, and so on. But in the Warsaw suburbs, street houses, they can defend by themselves. So they destroyed a lot of German tanks. But completely, Warsaw was surrounded. That's where we got hit on the 13th day of war, when they closed the ring. And Hitler was furious because they announced they took Warsaw, actually didn't take Warsaw. And now there were planes bombing every day. Artillery was shooting day and night. We were in basement. And Polish artillery was still shooting at German planes.
Who was in charge of the family? Was it your older sister?
No, there was a guy who was in charge of our column with this. He was a good friend of my father. So he was belonged to some farmers association, something, and there was his office. He brought us over there. We were with him. In the meantime, he tried to get us to some other committee, which was organized committee to take children of refugees, children and so on. So he sent us to another street over there. And there's Polish Boy Scout organization, if I remember. And there were a lot of children. Besides us, there were some children who lost parents, who were lost and so on. And that was in Krakowskie Przedmieście. That's where we were. But we had still our pillows, you know, blankets in that place when that guy was. So we used to go to see him sometimes during siege of Warsaw. And I remember we were walking and suddenly in front of us the shell exploded. I don't know why we didn't get killed or nothing. So we went in the little apartment building and janitor said, "Children, come inside, don't stay outside," you know. Artillery was pounding day and night. In meantime, which I didn't know, the Russian armies on the 17th day of war attacked us from east part of Poland. And that place where we are going was in Russian hands. So you would never make it. Mm-hmm. Even if you made it, then the Russian, you know, which I learned later because I was in the Polish Second Corps in Italy, Polish Army, who were mostly ex-prisoners from gulags, Polish. So Russians were deporting the whole families, including Polish officers, were they killed. So I didn't know at that time during siege of Warsaw. I only know what was happening over there. And that was lasted for a long time. Finally, the German planes were practically flying above the roof. There was no artillery shooting at them, bombing. And 2 weeks later, on 27th of September, Warsaw capitulated. And suddenly, when there was hell, bombing, shooting, suddenly peaceful, quiet. And that peace, it bothered you because you got used to that constant bombing, shelling, and so on. And I remember there was a placard on the wall that commanding officer said, because of lack of ammunition, lack of water, lack of food, we had to capitulate. But don't lose your help. We still have very powerful allies, France and England and Poland, you know, so on. That's what he said. But what I found out later, French supposed to open second front, you know, when we were fighting against Germans, but didn't do. The British were dropping, you know, some flyers. And here we are fighting and so on. So Warsaw capitulated. But there was another pocket, Modlin, where forces still fighting. There was at the Danzig area, we're still fighting. Lvov were still fighting. And Lvov was fighting first against Germans, again, and then against Russians. So we got in that situation. So funny, when Warsaw capitulated, fortunately I was in that committee. They took us children to Skolimov, which was suburbs of Warsaw. Before the war, there was children going on vacation, they have some facilities. But because we are in basement, never washed, everything, we were full of lice. And pretty soon there was a winter, because Warsaw capitulated, then for a few months, then we were. So what they did, they took all our dresses, suit, during winter exposed to the cold weather, They cut our hair anywhere in best for about 1 week, which we enjoyed because kids were different from in different experiences. And so I was over there for a few months. Then what happened? Then lady in charge, she said to me, "Ziggy, you cannot stay here. You need education. You have to go to school. What I'm going to do, I'm going to send you to Warsaw. You'll be able to have education." And there was another orphanage, at first was run by Polish Red Cross. So I went over there, there was a lot of children, some without limbs, legs, some lost parents like myself and so on. But we were lucky, we had food, we had bed and so on.
Were you still with your sisters?
Yes, my sister stayed behind, that's where I am, but only I was transferred. But I was in contact with them.
Were you in contact with your father?
Oh, that's what I was going to tell you. Yeah. Don't forget that I mentioned in Lipno, that's where my father was chief of police, there was German minorities. They were looking for my father. And my brother, who was in the Polish army, he was in siege of Warsaw, which I didn't know, after capitulation, because Warsaw was fighting for such a long time, very generous German allowed them to go home. Usually go to prison of war, so he went home. But Germans were looking for my father, and here is his son. Fortunately, my brother, we used to teach giving help to the German student before the war, Latin and Greek, so he developed very good relationship. And those Germans liked my brother. Of course, they hated my father. So what happened? So my father, he moved to an entirely different part of Poland. And he joined the police over there under German occupation. He was afraid about my brother. So he wrote a letter to his friend in village. And he signed not Jarkiewicz, his name, called Borsukiewicz. But my father got typical writing, so this guy knew at once. He said, "Go tell my son to get out." But my brother Zygmunt, he said, "No, I can't live because our aunt was sick, so I want to stay with her." That's what happened. In the meantime, I found out that two policemen who served under my father, they came back, and of course they were murdered by Gestapo. As a matter of fact, all my teachers from high school, in course of war, they were taken to concentration camps. I believe only one came alive from concentration camp. That town, Lipno, had maybe about 12,000 people, but maybe one-third or fourth were Jewish. They had businesses, stores, and so on. And what I had after the war, only 9 of them came back from concentration war after the war.
9 people
from they perished. They perished. This is like my professors, they perished. And my brother, and what happened? Now let's come to my brother now. I got a letter from my brother. So my brother, that German, they took over banks, all the other things, and my brother was is working for the Germans. They're sending him here like a gopher, go here, go there, and so on. And the guy who gave him that work, he liked my brother. So my brother, as I mentioned, he spoke German because he learned German in high school. So one day, on Saturday, everybody left the office. And only my brother was in that. It came young German, full of, like a Hitler, you can say, "Hi Hitler!" So my brother answered, "Guten Morgen." He didn't like it. He said, "Ich habe gesagt, Hi Hitler!" So my brother raised the voice too. He said, "Ich habe gesagt, Guten Morgen." There was consternation. And again he said, "I have gesagt Heil Hitler." And my brother said, "I had gesagt Guten Morgen. Fortunately, at that time came that German who was in charge. He grabbed that young German, kicked him out. But that was against my brother. He said in April, a few months after the capitulation of Poland, he heard early in the morning a lot of dogs were barking and so on. They took a lot of prominent people, about 300 from that little town, including my brother. They took him and from other towns, and about 1,000 of them from other surrounding places, they took the Saxon houses, concentration camp, or on Oranienburg outside Berlin. I didn't know anything because what happened? I saw on the map, the western part of Poland, German incorporated in the Third Reich. That was the Germany. That little district, Warsaw, Krakow, Oświęcim, you know, Auschwitz, was made like an area for Poles. In that was Polish police. We had Polish schools. When I say schools, trade schools, because all high schools were closed. Like in Krakow, there was very famous Jagiellonian University when the Polish pop was teaching and many Polish scientists. Professors came and they thought they would open, you know, the classes. So came Gestapo, beat them up in the Saxon concentration camp. And that was eliminated.
And they closed the university?
Oh, closed the university, closed the high schools. And then gradually, while the German army was still behaved to some extent correctly, then came German administration. I got also here recorded. Came governor of that area where it was Krakow, Warsaw, Frank. Of course, that if he worked peacefully for the third, you know, great German land and so on, then they have, this will be okay. Except Jews, they have no place, you know, that I have this only recorded anyway. So that's what. So what they did first thing they confiscated our radios. So we had no access because we didn't know. England is still fighting, France is still fighting, we didn't know anything, no radios.
When your brother was picked up, was much of the town also deported at that time?
As I mentioned, I was in Warsaw. And there was a border between that area, which Governor Frank was ruling, and Third Reich. In Third Reich, it was much worse. Nobody dared to speak Polish language. A lot of people couldn't speak language. What I learned later, when there was German coming on the side, on the street, Poles had to step aside, sometimes to tip his hat. If he, you know, but in Warsaw, they couldn't control so much at first. There was German army, but, you know, so there was a big difference. This like later became like a, in Warsaw, ghetto, a wall, and I was in ghetto, but I'll tell you later about that incident. So that was. So, you know, they cut off from all information toward the Western world. Later, they introduced curfew. From 9 o'clock till 5 o'clock in the morning, nobody could be on the street. So we were like prison. In the meantime, the issue ordered that all of Jewish origin had to carry Star of David. And in Poland, there were no young Jewish in this country. About 60% they were Orthodox. When you look at him, you knew he was Jewish. They spoke even Yiddish quite often and so on. And I remember shortly after Warsaw capitulated, I was walking on the street, I was 14 years old, and one Jewish was walking, an ordinary German soldier started to kick him, beat him. I was mad, but I could do nothing. And it wasn't like a Gestapo, the ordinary soldier, that would burn me out. So Jews were not allowed to be working in this, you know, offices and all the, they were limiting them. Don't forget that they finally introduced food on ration. I was always hungry. I don't know whether I saw sugar, meat or something. They have ersatz. Ersatz, it means like substitute for margarine, for something and so on. But I was still lucky I was in that orphanage. I had place to sleep, place to eat, and so I started to go to the trade school. Trade school, that's what Germans allowed. So you learn your trade in the evening. Then my teacher, no, my lady who was in charge of that orphanage, she said, Ziggy, you have to learn some profession. You cannot go just evening school if you listen, you know. But she said, I know one electrical engineer across the street from our orphanage. So we are going to take you. I already talked to him. You go and start to work. I said, okay.
An apprentice,
yeah. But I had only one suit when we escaped. I didn't have even shoes. I had tennis shoes. So I went with that one suit. I went, and that electrical engineer said, don't you have overall, coverall or anything? I said, no, that's because you were on the new construction, building bricks. And I learned how to swear with those electricians, you know, all these guys, bricklayers. I was not prepared. But that guy, electrician, was very nice to me. He knew I was all in orphanage. And I was working, and he said, because, you know, I was very good with tools and anything. You know, I never was exposed to that. So he said, who was your father? So I said, chief of police. You know, you better join the police force. You never make electrician. But anyway, he was very nice to me, evidently. Then, that company, that electrical engineer and another electrical engineer, they form a little company and got different works. And what happened? They got job in Gestapo headquarters. And Gestapo headquarters was on Aleja Szucha, later Germans called it Sicherheitspolizei, Security Police Street. And that was before there was Ministry of Education, building, huge building and so on. So they removed everything and Gestapo headquarters moved in. What happened? In the basement, they wanted bar room, Bierstube, you know, for beer and so on. And in order to have a fresh air, they have fans, one exhausting, one, you know, air, and that's where we came, and with that electrician, I went over there. And quite often, I had special pass, not through the main gate, but side door, we showed that, and we went over there. And I was over there, I heard big screams, human, incredible screams. Evidently, they got some members of the Polish underground army and they were torturing them. But I was afraid to go and investigate because, you know. And I remember one day we were working and that electrician said, Ziggy, I have to connect, energize these fans. But I could disconnect, but I'm afraid because they might have a radio station come, you know, and they were accusing me of sabotage, you know, against Germans. So I said, I'm going to connect them. You open like a door, and there was copper bars, and there was 380 volts electrical, you know, current flowing in that. He said, look, I would try to connect when they're still hot. But if something happens to me, don't grab me by hand. Just grab my over and pull me. I said, yeah, I do. I didn't pay attention. In the meantime, I was watching Gestapo coming, and they were eating over there, drinking beer. Ha Hitler, ha Hitler, you know, suddenly. Ha Hitler, ha Hitler. I was watching them, and suddenly I heard the scream of my electrician. I got panicky, I couldn't pull him. So with all my strength, I pulled him, and blood was coming here. He grabbed evidently two copper bars. and he was lying. And one Gestapo noticed, he came and said, what happened? In perfect Polish. Perfect Polish, he spoke Polish, but then lied it. I said, well, he was connected. Why didn't he disconnect? I said, he was afraid, you know. Anyway, so that, fortunately this guy survived. He was trembling for 1 week, and so I saved his life, so more or less that. Then, as I mentioned, there was shortage of food, separated Jewish population from us. Then, no radio, curfew.
Did you know anyone in Warsaw?
And before the war, I didn't know anybody. But there's a lot of people who came from the part of Poland which was incorporated to Germans. As a matter of fact, Germans came, kicked them out. They took their possession, you know, everything, kicked them out to the area where I was in Warsaw.
That was called the general government?
General government, that's what they called that. So what happened, I was walking the street and I met my friend from high school. Hey Ziggy, how are you? And then, I want just to mention, when Warsaw capitulated, there was such a depression, horrible, that I had few officers committed suicide. They couldn't stand Poland gaining independence after 123 years, and now they lost again. And you walk on the street, horses were lying on the street, people cutting you know, meat from horses because there was shortage. Streets were, you know, few weeks later you smell that fresh, sweet stink from the, you know, from these builders who were still in the rubble. So it was horrible situation. So I met that friend and he said, come on, see me. So I met his parents. His parents were good friends of my parents. And as I mentioned, depression, hopelessness, people were, you know, they said our government betrayed us, we lost the war so quickly, you know, but it wasn't true. But we didn't realize at that time that Germans were so powerful. So I went over there, met his parents, they asked me about my father. At that time I didn't know anything about my father yet, later I found out. So they closed the windows and pulled out little leaflets from the Polish underground army. And and of course, don't lose your hope, war is not over, and so on. So that was the first sign that something was going wrong. Okay, then I was...
You told them about your mother?
Yes, I told them about my mother and so on and so on. So they found out everything. Then while I was going to evening classes, then there two guys came to our orphanage. They were more or less my age. I got their pictures. And they were not for a very long time and so on. So they said, well, Ziggy, how are you? Where you come from? They found out everything about me. I got some pictures, you know, my father in Polish and so on. And finally they said, listen, we belong to the Polish underground army. Well, we would like you to join. But you know what happens. If you are captured, nobody will help you. If you are still alive, they were going to torture you. So he said, just think about it. So I was thinking. Then he said, sometime later, did you think? I said, yes. In the meantime, my father found us. So he came to visit me. Of course, he didn't go to that place where he was before the war chief of police. But he came to visit me and we're talking. And so he took all my sisters to the different part of Poland. But I was still in Warsaw. So he said, Ziggy, don't get mixed up in anything. You lose your life, you won't save Poland and so on. And that's what he said. But then I decided to join underground army, regardless of what my father said, because I saw this persecution, you know, everything. I said, I cannot be just then. So I joined, and...
Was there any hesitation?
Pardon?
Was there any hesitation on your part?
No, it wasn't hesitation. When you were young, you take, you know, you don't think about. Now I would be thinking twice. But that time, young, Germans killed my mother, brought the concentration camps, they persecuting Jews, Poles, and so on, my teachers. So I had only everything to, you know, to join.
Did you know that your brother was in a concentration?
Yes, I knew it, but we found out 6 months later when he was arrested. He was arrested in April 1940, a few months afterwards then. But for 6 months, we didn't know what happened when he was arrested. Then first card he sent to my aunt in Lipno, which she notified that my brother was alive in concentration camp. Later he sent card to us, but he was allowed to send only one card in German language, and when we answer, also in German language, so we had to ask somebody to translate. I didn't know that to my father. So that's the way it was. I got lost and wound.
So the family of your school friend, they were the ones who told the underground army about you?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So what happened? So then I decided to join. So they said, they explained to me, we have such a system. The smallest unit is section. In each section is five guys. So he said, but we want you to assume some name, pseudonym. So I assumed my name Longin. Why? Because if somebody, my friend, was captured by Gestapo and tortured, he couldn't reveal my name because he didn't know my real name. That's the way it operated. And three sections was platoon and so on, but I had no access to them. So then finally he said, Ziggy, when I was just for a few months, you be sworn in as a full-fledged member of the Polish Underground Army. I have translation, maybe I give you that, the way we are sworn in. So they brought us to one place, I never been in that little room, and there was about five of us, plus that guy who introduced me, plus the another cadet officer, Julek. His pseudonym was Julek, I never saw him in my life. And then he put crucifix and we swore that we know and so on, warned that if any betrays, they will execute us automatically, if any betrays and so on, there was nothing. So I was sworn in, and then we had meetings.
What was your assumed name?
Longin. L-O-N-G-I-N. There's a Polish hero from the history, but that's, I just assumed that name. So most of my friends I knew by assumed name, except that guy who introduced me, because we had meeting at his house. And a lot of people...
How often would you have the meeting?
Whenever they tell you that there was, we are kids. When I joined, I was 16. When I was sworn in, I was 17. So they said, hey, we meet this, meet there, you know. It wasn't like military, because it sounds underground army, but it was like kids. Hey, Longin, we meet there tomorrow and so on. That's the way at the beginning. But with the time, this situation was getting worse and worse.
Now, your father didn't want you to join.
That's what he said. I later found out that he was up to here in underground army, but that's another story which I come to it. So what happened? Then once I was sworn in, I never shoot from the rifle. I never had pistol. And how you are going to teach those kids how to use guns when they never saw, never hand grenade? So what they did, they brought a pistol. So this pistol, revolver, how to load, how this. But they borrowed that. We didn't have any from another unit. And one day they told, as I mentioned, there was Gestapo headquarters. Around that area, the whole district was assigned for Germans. And they put barbed wires surrounding German this area, but street was going, through that area. Polish people could go, but at the entrance, there was German with a rifle and so on. So one day said, Ziggy, you take a briefcase from one, you get a briefcase from another guy, you give him, he gave me some words which I have to tell to him, he will give you that, and you bring for the next meeting. What happened? There was a rifle, but the whole barrel was cut off, the other cut off, only that portion when you put, shells. And I got that briefcase, and I was stupid. And I went on that car which going to the German district. I don't know whether there was ammunition, I didn't know where it was loaded. So finally, we come to that barbed wire, German was standing right up, halt! And I'm standing. My briefcase is lying here, and I'm looking at him, and there's a big wall. I couldn't even jump over that, or if he tried to then. I look back, it was...
No, you did or didn't know what was in the briefcase?
No, but... I knew it. They told me. They told me there is that. But today I would check whether I have ammunition or this, but that time, you kids, they don't think. So I took that and I brought for the meeting. And then somebody else took that. Now,
what happened? When you were stopped. They just let you go?
Oh, no, yeah, they should stop. He looked inside the streetcar. There was three or four passengers, and I was just at the here, and my briefcase was lying there behind my back, and he just stopped. They couldn't, so I went. Then what happened? Then we had another problem. One of our guys, Pietrek, his name was. I never had a gun. Only on a few occasions they gave me borrow gun because the idea was to disarm Germans to get guns, but we had to borrow from them because we didn't have any guns. So what happened? That Pietrek, he was some on missions doing something, and he was walking on Bratska Street, and Gendarmeria, the police, we call it gendarmerie, they stopped him and they wanted to, to search him. And he pulled out the gun, shot one and was running. While was running, there was a group of German soldiers they wanted to stop him. So he shot at them and ran in the building. And they surrounded him. And they was shooting, and finally he ran out of ammunition. And what happened, when he ran out of ammunition, then he knew that is the end. But he still had hand grenade. So he figured out, if I throw hand grenade, I get wounded. There's slim chance that my friends from the Persian Negro Army will rescue me. Because I know the Germans will try to, go for interrogation to reveal names of other guys. And that was exactly what happened. He threw hand grenade exploded, but he threw too close to him. He lost the whole arm, his leg saved, and they put him in the Polish hospital. Actually, it was clinic, not big hospital, clinic. And there were two Germans at his room watching. Then they replaced them by Polish policemen. And in meantime, Polish doctors notify his mother that he is in that place. So the other members of Polish underground army, they wanted to rescue him. So they talked to the doctors. Listen, why don't you take him to operating table on another room and we get from there? But everybody was afraid. Everybody had children, family, you know. There was collective responsibility. It was not like that. They were trying to help. So finally, what they agreed that they employ a girl from the Polish Underground Army as a nurse. So she was with him all the time. Why these policemen were watching him? Then he told her, listen, if they don't rescue you, tell them to give me poison. I don't want to go for interrogation. So she said, don't worry, we are watching everything. Then she one day she found out that they, in the afternoon they are taking him to Gestapo for interrogation. In the meantime, there were no private cars in Poland during German occupation. But people were driving ambulances, city cars, and other things, you know. So somehow through the chain of connections, they got in touch with guy who was driving ambulance. So he said, I need only, you know, half an hour or something, you know, notice, so I come any place you want me. And that girl who was planted in that clinic, she learned in the morning that in the afternoon they taking him to Gestapo for interrogation. So what he did, she called guys. I was at, I don't know, at school. They couldn't in touch with me, but they got in touch with other guys, about seven of them. They had two borrowed pistols. And that guy with ambulance, we didn't know who he was. He just came and was waiting outside that thing, which is normal in hospital, clinic, is ambulance. So three guys enter that hospital, and Janice says, Eddie, wait a moment. Where are you going? Be pistol, sit down, be quiet. So he will sit down. And that nurse took them on the second floor, and there were two policemen. So the guys pull out pistols and hands up. And one of the Polish policemen, he didn't. He just tried to pull up. So they shot him right in the belly. He fell down. They put our friend on stretchers. Ambulance took off. And there was a school for nurses. And they held that shot. And they asked my friend, what happened? I said, we are from the Polish Underground Army, and be quiet. And they left. Germans were looking for him at the all different roads going out of Warsaw, but never met him. He survived, and he was later fighting 2 years later in Warsaw Uprising without his arm. And I have the book about him. That was the one incident. Another incident, which I was not too familiar with too much, but one of our members betrayed us. Why he betrayed? He was going to pick up some information somewhere on the street fighting or something, and Gestapo, instead of getting that information from guy, Gestapo was waiting, arrested him. And they tortured him. And he somehow didn't reveal the name of guys, but they brought his parents and started to torture in front of him. He broke down, and he agreed to cooperate, which we didn't know. And one day or one night, they arrested many guys, including Cadet Officer Julek, which I was sworn in by him. And they took him to Pawiak. Pawiak was close to ghetto area, infamous prison, a lot of Poles. And then they were taking him to Auschwitz concentration camp. At that time, guard was still Polish, pre-war Polish. So sometimes some of them cooperated with the Polish. Anyway, somehow they asked to give a piece of bar, iron bar, they put in the sleeve, and thus they put it on the train, machine gun, and some of them were going. So on the way, they tried to break, the floor or wall, I don't know exactly what they did. Other guys said, don't do it because they kill all of us. But anyway, he and few others managed to escape. Germans were shooting at them, but somehow he survived. He came back to Warsaw, and now they try to figure out what happened, who betrayed us. And finally, they came to the conclusion that this guy, they found out somehow, you know, that he killed him. Of course, we issued order to kill him. Because if his parents were hostages, regardless, he should notify us, but he didn't. He cooperated with the Germans. So the result was such, there were three times they were trying to kill him, finally they got him. And before he died, he begged only that his name won't be revealed in the Polish underground newspaper that he betrayed his friends. That's one. Okay, now, situation was getting hard. The Germans were executing mostly at night. Then Jews were in Jewish district. They didn't tell you that they're going to, you know, to murder you. But a lot of people got notion that, like the during First World War, you know, this restriction. Nobody thought that would be such a diabolic plan like Hitler had. So anyway, then when I finished 18 years of age, everybody was kicked out from orphanage, including me. Why? Because a lot of young guys belonged to the Polish underground army.
From the orphanage?
Yes. A lot of orphanages in Warsaw, there was a lot of young guys, and many of them belonged to the underground army. I belong in my own orphanage, and except that guy who introduced me, I later found out the others were too, but they didn't tell me anything. So I didn't know, you know, because we risk your life.
You didn't know about each other.
I know. So now I was 18, and another guy, Wojtek Zaleski, he was also, and they said, you have to leave, you cannot stay with the orphanage. Because administration was afraid if Gestapo catch any of us, they'll close the orphanages, period. So then I was looking. Don't forget that a lot of buildings were destroyed during the siege of Warsaw. Second, nobody wanted young guys. They were afraid to rent to anybody. They were short of glass. But so finally I and my friend, we got one little room from the elderly couple, and we rented that little room. There was only one bed, of course, never heated during winter, no kitchen, nothing to wash. There was one on corridor or something. But we are young, you know, during those days you are just yourself. But before that, when I was 16 years old, I'm jumping back to when I was 16 years old, everybody had to register to the Labor Department. I got still an original ID here from Labor Department. You had to work, or if you're going to evening school or something, there was exception. Then what happened? Then they wanted German introduce ID cards. Everybody had ID cards, fingerprints, and so on. I still have right here, I'll show you later, my original German ID card. And on the ID card, it says place where you are living, address. But before they kicked me out from orphanage, I found out that Germans allowed in what used to be Warsaw Polytechnic very advanced courses in electrical engineering. And I wanted to go over there. But I didn't finish high school before the war. I needed some calculus and integral calculus and all this stuff. But I took special courses, and that would allow me to take entrance exam. But I was in 18, I was not allowed to join then. So I talked to priest who was in charge of the boys, guys, of the boys in that orphanage. I said, Father, I can, what do you mean you can't go? Let's go with me. He went to that and he talked to director. After 20 minutes, you are admitted to, you know, to take entrance exam. You better pass that exam. But that was not everything. Now, in order to be admitted, I had to go to Gestapo for permit. So they gave me some little, paper, and so I went to Gestapo. It was different entrance where I used to go when I was working over there. I enter and there was two or three German Gestapo and asked me, Haben Sie Waffen? Do we have guns? I said, nein. They search me, okay, and they let me go and they check. And they call morality standard, whatever, they didn't tell me that. Evidently I was on their list or suspected. So I went to that. And I passed exam and I started to attend that school. I have still some pictures here. And also the student card, I still got here with that with me. So I'll show you later. Then as I mentioned, when I was 18, I had to look for an apartment. I found that apartment with an elderly couple. They said, I give you this apartment under one condition. Nobody will visit you here. Nobody. There are a lot of Germans, Volksdeutsche, which is called Polish citizens who became Germans, or who were Germans and were cooperating. Nobody trusted anybody. So I said, yes, 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 well, of course, everybody cares. We didn't have any guns. There are some drops from England, I believe, in parties at other places, but some people were guns from the city of Warsaw, which were thinking about, well, I never thought about, you know, that we all need a gun, and nobody at that time was thinking. So they suddenly they said, we have to disarm Germans. How can you disarm Germans when the street was a lot of soldiers? Besides, we didn't have any guns. So they borrowed two guns from another unit. I wasn't at that time, but my friend who introduced me to the operation, the Grand Army, who was more or less in charge, they were looking for Germans in suburbs of Warsaw, not even because there was very rarely we got a lot of Germans. And there were two Germans and three of our guys were walking behind them. But Germans look around once, look around, they saw three my friends walking behind. They stopped the streetcar and they left. They evidently suspected that something is fishy going on. And as usual, the other guy said, well, we should do it, we should do it. Heroes after when German left, but before, you know, there were not enough courage to do anything. And they go around and it goes the German soldier with the German woman, auxiliary units we did in German army. So finally my friend pulled out pistol, stopped in front of German Hände hoch. And he said, panie, 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 in Polish, here, sir. And you know, one guy was shaky and he shot and hit that German in head and he fell down. The other one grabbed, you know, that pistol. And they started to run away. In the meantime, that German from auxiliary unit, she was running, and my friend just bumped in her. And she thought he was going to kill her, so he pushed her aside. People said, what happened? What happened? She said, somebody killed Germans. But he was the one who killed the Germans, and they escaped. And then we got first pistol. We didn't have pistol. Now.
Now, was this from a Volksdeutsch?
Pardon?
The pistol was from whom?
From a German soldier. It was Parabellum, 9mm Parabellum. They got that.
Okay.
And then, but he couldn't resist because I didn't take part in that action. He came to see me. And I said, Darek, be quiet. Amazingly, she got such a sensitive hearing that I wish I had that when I was young. So I said, Darek, be quiet. But he was still telling me, you know, and he left. And I remember, it was Sunday, I went to the church, I came back, and my roommate Wojtek said, Ziggy, you have to move out. I said, what do you mean move out? She heard that your friend Darek was here, and she said, you have to move out. Then she comes. She said, I told you that this. There's a lot of Germans, I don't want to move out, I don't want to listen to anything. I said, Grandma, I didn't invite him, he just came. I don't care where he came, you know, and in that shrieking voice, I never forget it, you know. I said, Grandma, I didn't invite him, I didn't do anything. So finally he let me stay. So I stay over there. Then, what happened? When I was still in orphanage, I'm still jumping back in just a few months. Mm-hmm. When I was coming from a trade school, I saw on the sidewalk a lot of blood, and janitors washing blood from the sidewalk. And they said about 5-10 minutes before me, they brought in front of my orphanage 30 Poles, they stopped traffic and executed them. And they took that, and then a few days later I saw some candles, some flowers and so on. But that was every daily occurrence, because before they were killing in a concentration camp, in the woods and somewhere, and now, because Polish underground army was getting so strong, they wanted to introduce panic among people. But the result was opposite. Because if I am going to die, I'm going to die fighting. And also, I was sorry.
These were Polish civilians just killed on the street.
I still got some documents here too. If German got killed,
reprisal.
There were reprisals. Usually they stopped about 100, 200 people. And then you had ID card, everything. And even if you had everything in order, even if you are working, they put you against the wall. And 100 they were executing. And this announcement, which I got still here, I show you in German that, you know, there were warnings that if anything happens in the future, that the next group will be exempt. But it was happened practically every day or every week in the whole Poland. We lost 6 million people. You know how many people Warsaw lost? 2/3, 800,000. That's more than total losses of the United States. That includes Polish Jews in Warsaw. Every third inhabitant in Warsaw was Jewish. Don't forget that. And so that will happen. But quite often, I don't know, but I can, because I'm jumping here. But anyway, before they move Jews to Jewish district and later becomes ghetto, they were marching them on the streets, cleaning streets, and they were marching. German was going on pavement, and they was on the road. There were German, about 50, 60 Jewish. And I look at them, and you know, there was horrible sight, because I was treated badly, but they were even worse. And they were singing, Marsza Wek Szmigwiric, nie nauczył nas nic, a nasz Hitler złoty nauczył nas roboty. The Germans told them to sing. Polish Marszał Szmigwiric didn't teach us anything, but on God Hitler did taught us how to work. And they, those poor people were marching. Then, in meantime, when I was working, I got work with the German branch, Allgemeine Elektrizitätsgesellschaft company, which was had project electrical substation on the railway works. And that railway works, there was about 2,000 Poles in different branches, different sections employed on the railway. And we were making new substation, you know, the power supplies for different holes, different equipment and so on. So I was started to work over there. But at the entrance, there was Ukrainians, because a lot of Ukrainians cooperated with Germans. They were even worse than Germans in some cases. So we went through that gate and so on, and quite often Germans brought Jews from a ghetto. They brought them over there. They had to clean hallways and all the street, and those were the lucky ones, because they got chance to get touch with the Poles. And what happened? Usually they have little bag. They traded. If you get your ring or something, they traded for food. Now, there was hunger in Warsaw. In ghetto, forget, even much worse. But so the Polish workers, they got watch, ring, something, got to the farms somewhere outside Warsaw, and traded with farms for food, for, you know, other stuff. Don't forget that every cow and pig had its own number. And if you kill that pig without any, you know, then now you're in trouble. That's the way my aunt and uncle died, because they had little piggy they killed, and they took him to concentration camp, and they died over there.
That was your aunt in your hometown?
No, not my hometown. They live about 40 miles from us, from Lipno. And I never met her, but her husband I met, so my uncle had met. So that's what happened. But Germans couldn't control everything. Towns, the people and so on. They had a lot of spies. Then infiltrated quite often Polish underground army. But we also infiltrated their administration. Like I learned after the war, there was secretary of Gestapo headquarters from Vienna, from Austria. She was with them, she had papers, everything. But she got in touch with the Polish underground army. Only few persons knew that she was working for us. So there was anything. There were Poles who were betraying Poles. Some being tortured, some just for some gain or some other things. There were Poles who were betraying Jews. There were Jews who were cooperating with the Russian NKVD and so on. So there is not such a clear cut, you know, like nobody. This is like United States. We had country friends, guys from CIA working for Soviet Union. They're spying, atom spies. So, you know, there was not many, but there were cases. So it's not rosy like you would think. There was guys, bandits, who simply got opportunity to get rich. And what happened?
Well, before the war,
yeah,
there was a mix of people in your town.
Yes.
Different religions, nationalities.
Yeah, not many. Uh-huh. Jewish and Germans.
Uh-huh.
Not like in this country.
Right. And most of the Polish in your town were Catholics?
I would say 95% were Catholic. There were some who were Lutherans. There were some who were Germans, but Polonized. Mm-hmm. As an example, when shortly after the Warsaw capitulated, in December, outside Warsaw, in Otwock, there was barroom, and two Germans came or something, and of course they were, you know, they were like acting like God, and Poles don't get easy scared. They started to fight and they killed two Germans. Next day, or the same day, I don't know exactly, but I was still a record, they pulled out from bed in pyjamas during winter, that's in December, just before Christmas, over 100 Poles, and they were executing them. And one of them, his name was Gering, you know, like Marshal Gering in Germany. So that commanding officer said, "You are German." He said, "No, I am Polish." Put him aside. Then this guy saw those killing people killed. He called him, he said, "Tell me that you are German or save your life." He said, "No, I am Polish." And they killed him. And he was uncle of girl from the island, which I met later, that girl who got killed. So there were Poles who cooperating with Germans. Not many, mm-hmm, but there were cases.
Yeah. But before the war, did people get along? Did they mix?
There was no problem. They get along, we were friendly with Germans, Germans were friendly with us. There was nothing, this seemed like Jewish people. However, Jewish were, because they were Orthodox, very religious type. They didn't mix with the Catholic didn't mix with Jewish. They were mixed marriages, but very real, not like here, there was this. And, but like a state within state, quite often they spoke their own language, Yiddish. They had some, their schools, They have some, you know, actually the Poland had more Jews than Jews in Palestine. At one time, 4/5 of all Jewish in the world were the Kingdom of Poland and Lithuania. Why? Because in Spain, Inquisition, the Jews were kicked out. Then the Jews were kicked out from England, from Austria, from other countries. Where did they go? They went to Kingdom of Poland, because Poland was the most liberal country. That's when you say the 6 million Jews died in the Second World War, half of them were from Poland, because there was a big concentration camp. All leaders in Israel later, they were mostly born in Poland. If you went after the war to Israel, you could speak Polish. There's Polish newspaper. For instance, Begin. Begin was in the Polish army in where was it? Okay, I'm jumping. Sister asked me this question, I have to answer. When Hitler conquered the whole Europe, in 22nd of June 1941, only England survived. United States even wasn't at war. He attacked Russia. And I remember this freshly, you know, proud German army going to Russia and so on. And Russians stopped them at the Moscow and Stalingrad, that's the order, because during winter everything and so on. So, Polish government in exile in London established diplomatic relationship with Stalin. Don't forget that Stalin attacked Poland with Hitler. There was such a ticklish situation, but Churchill insisted because they needed the Russian to defeat Hitler. So Polish Marshal, General Sikorsky went and talked to Stalin. And thousands of Poles, 1.5 million Poles were deported to Russia. Of course, Polish officers were already killed by Stalin, which nobody knew at that time. Then Sikorsky, I remember, I have still book here, you know, I got all these documents, so just in case if you want. Then Sikorsky talked to Stalin, and he says, well, we agreed last time that you are going to release all Polish citizens. You don't release Ukrainians, Polish citizens, and Jews. And Stalin said, what are the Jews? They are no good soldiers. You know, that's what Stalin said, something like that. But when I was in the Polish army in Italy, there was about 4,000 Jewish. Sometimes you didn't know whether it's Jewish or not, but they were Jewish. And another situation was that Polish army, when Polish government exile wanted to get to the west, out of Russia, because they showed shortage of food, they were treated like sick people in that labor camp. So they moved them to Iran, later with the British to Iraq and Palestine. And about 3,000 of them deserted from Polish army, Jews, including Prime Minister Begin. He was in the Polish army. Now, Palestine was at that time under British administration. And those Jews formed the terroristic organization, Zwei Lumi, I don't remember. And also Begin. And Begin, if I remember correctly, they blew up one Hotel David, that lot of British officers were killed. British put pressure on General Anders, who was in charge of the Polish army. Why did you send MP and get those? Anders said, look, they feel their country, I don't want anything to do. So that's the way it was. When I joined the Polish army in Italy, in my company, there were few Jews. So what happened? When it came Saturday, they had special lorry and they went to synagogue or somewhere and they came back, you know. And we had, not only, we had Ukrainians. We hated a lot of them because they were Germans, but they were in Polish army, they were Polish citizens. So there's nothing, you know, this...
Was the Germans paying Polish people to turn in Jews?
Yes. Not only... I don't know, I am not witness, but I got enough information. Polish people. First of all, whom we are dealing with. If you're dealing with bandits who could kill his own mother, he didn't give a damn. They betray Poles, they betray Jews. And I heard about, you've heard about Jan Karski? Mm-hmm. Okay, I met him here, he sent me a book, I have his book, he described everything. There were Poles who Jew was hiding somewhere. There were cases when the Poles betrayed them. As a matter of fact, in the secret Polish newspaper, twice during the occupation, I read that sergeant of the Polish police was executed by Polish underground army because he betrayed Jew. Twice I saw that. There is, in Poland, for saving Jew, was automatically dead or your family were losing. Not like in France, you know, in Holland. When I saw Frank, the Irish in Holland, that Jewish girl, they went to Gestapo, asked them to release them. In Poland, they would surround the whole house and everybody would be killed. So occupation was not the same. I found out when I escaped to Czechoslovakia. I don't know, finished today. Long story. Anyway. So, and the striking evidence in charge of the whole Polish underground army was General Grot Rowecki. His pseudonym was Grot. Whenever he issued any orders to kill Germans or something, he signed Grot. But his real name was Rowecki. They said that my name was Longin, but it wasn't my name. So that's the way they operated. You know what happened to him? He was betrayed by Paul. And German arrested him. They took him to Gestapo headquarters. I don't think they tortured him because he was high ranking and he they took him, Polish underground army was trying to attack headquarters, but Germans were very quick, very shortly took him on the plane, sent them to Berlin, and then to Sachsenhaus concentration camp, that camp where my brother was. Mm-hmm. And what I read later, they tried to get some of agreement with him, because Polish underground army were harassing Germans, especially during the when they invaded Russia, all transport, trains were going through Poland. If you blow a bridge or something, you know, and a lot of guns we got from Germans. Simply they're stealing from trains. And so even bought guns from Germans. They came from Eastern Front, and Eastern Front was not in the West. They were tough. They were the prisoners of war, they were shooting, you know. In the West, they said, that is my number, I'm so on. Forget it. That's why for punishment, Germans sent their troops, guys, to Eastern Front. So it wasn't so easy. But sometimes they came for 1 week or something, vacation to Warsaw. The first thing, they went, you know, to bar room, drink. Of course, they wanted prostitute or something. But a lot of prostitutes were working for us. So, and we bought one submachine gun from a German soldier. He came from Eastern Front, he got enough of everything, you know. So he stole that gun from somebody, from magazine or from other German. He had good time, he went back to the Eastern Front. And we had that one pistol we had from German. In addition, that other sources, there were some drops from England. But mostly they were in forest, in partisan group, and so on. So it wasn't easy.
Were you connected at all with the partisan?
No, I was not connected. I was going to be connected. Why? Because I felt I needed action. In Warsaw, you were limited. Quite often you walk on the street and German patrols on the street. Quite during rush hour, they mixed with the people. And especially young guy who was, they quite often said, halt, hand the hoe. And if you were armed, I didn't have a gun, because we don't have any guns. But if gun, usually we carry guns here, and we had, you know, jacket button up. When Germans stop you, you know you don't have chance, so you pull out and they're shooting. So later they got smart. they let you go by, and from behind they call you Hände hoch. So that's the way it was. Now, I was still living in that with that my that gra, that my grandma, I call her grandma, an elderly couple. Then one day my friend said, Ziggy, my brother got birthday, actually name day in Polish. Let's go and celebrate. And that was in a rough district, like Richmond or something, you know, the people wouldn't go. So yeah, I went over there. I didn't know the guys. I only knew him. And they had music, harmony, about four guys and few girls, and they're dancing. And suddenly the window breaks and bottle landed among us. Bottle through the window. But it was Rav District. What happened? These guys from the Rav District, I don't know, bandits or, you know, these hooligans, whatever you call them, they come and wanted to break our party. And we are kids. We are 18, 17, 20. And there's already one guy was pushing inside, the guy said, get out, and I was pushing. So he kicked him out, and he fell down the steps. So when he fell down the steps, then this guy get on the street and threw, you know, this bottle. But there was the whole bunch of them. And we were in the Rav District, and they gunk against us, which I didn't know because I was inside this apartment. So guys said, guys, we have to quit, we have guns. I didn't have them, but they had guns. We have to quit because we don't want to, you know. So they quickly took, and one was, his sister was with him. So they left, and this guy grabbed, you know, little axe, and after him, we assure you, you know. So this guy pulled out a gun, and whoop, whoop. Then this guy realized that he, you know, he's dealing with the, you know, just ordinary people. But what happened, there was school of the Polish police, and they grabbed that Polish, our friend, and they arrested him. I don't know what happened. Now, guy at his apartment and his birthday, I was, said, Ziggy, I cannot stay in this apartment. I have to move out. So I said, okay, I go to you. I said, listen, I have my grandmother, I can't get you, I can't get Ziggy only tonight. Tomorrow, I said, Steve, I can't get you. Said, Ziggy, tonight, tomorrow, I find another place. I didn't do anything, so he came. I said, tiptoe, quietly, peacefully, three of us lie down on the bed. I said, be quiet. So early in the morning, my roommate left. Only I stay with him. Then he said, Ziggy, I have to clean my pistol. So he removed his pistol on the blanket, you know, and took apart. And I heard the door opening in corridor. My aunt, my grandmother is coming. So I said, go under the bed. He went under the bed. I saw this part from the pistol, so I covered it with blanket. And she said, your room is dirty. You have to clean your room. But that was only excuse, because she heard something. She brought in a pail of water and throwing this and give me some brush or something, broom, or I don't know. I said, Grandma, I will do everything. But I will help you. She's under the bed. She is trying to help me. I don't know. And he said, and then his legs were sticking out. Oh my gosh, what is that? My friend came out, red on his face. He said, Ziggy, I couldn't find my shoe. He said, don't lie, you were hiding. I told you, I don't want anybody Germans living in this situation. I said, Grandma, there was police hour. And he couldn't go because, you know, there was a curfew. So I said, he stay and he go. But I told you, no. And I told her I have to move. But somehow she let me stay. This guy left and so on. Now I'm going back to the railway. On the other side, when I mentioned there was a railway, where Ukrainians' guard was when there was 2,000 people working, and Jewish were coming from ghetto clinic, distant halls and so on. There was, I remember, one German who was coming, mixing with the different halls, different workshop, and we saw any Pole standing. They took him to the security building, and usually what I heard, they tied his arms like that and put pipe and put rested that pipe on the tables and they're beating them over. And this guy was known that he was torturing Poles. So one day I'm coming to work, he got killed yesterday. Polish underground army finished him. Of course, so there was a lot of sabotage also in that railway, but you had to be careful because there was reprisals. And I don't forget, they came Jews to our substation, there was 3 or 5 of them, and there was trading with Polish workers. And then I didn't trade, I had nothing to trade, I mean, this. But next time there came a young Jewish girl, maybe she was 18, but you could see that she was better family house, the way she responded, it was this. And at the end she said, maybe somebody will take me. Of course there was no response. It bothers me to this day. I couldn't help her. I couldn't bring to my apartment, I couldn't do nothing. And shortly afterwards, they were build the wall, of course. There was horrible hunger, which I didn't realize until I went to ghetto. I was hungry, but what I saw is beyond any comprehension. But to get to ghetto and get out of ghetto, there was no problem. There was streetcar, Polish streetcar going right through the ghetto, except on the platform there was Polish policemen. At that time you could bribe practically everybody. Germans are coming to Poland making money, bribing together with Polish policemen, except political Gestapo was different, but this ordinary German security, you couldn't do anything. You could give that Polish policeman little money and he turn around, he can jump out, he jump in and so on. And then one day I was close to the ghetto wall and I saw holes and a lot of young children. They were the best because parents, you could do nothing, but they were sneaking, you know, everywhere, bringing like potatoes or something, and I saw him from distance and so on. But then, as I mentioned, when I left to Poland, I mean, place when war started, I had only sneakers. Came winter, I was cold. I didn't have even hard snow. So in orphanage, I talked to my friend, Lucille, I am cold, I don't have anything. He said, Ziggy, go to ghetto. I said, what do you mean to ghetto? You go to ghetto and you pay 1/3 what you pay outside ghetto. I said, how can I get to ghetto? He said, I give you my pass. There was Jarkiewicz factory where he was going to ghetto work inside the ghetto. This is like some Jews were outside working outside ghetto. Not many, but there were some lucky ones who get out. So I said, sure. Today I would give you $1 million, I wouldn't go. But that time, when I was risking my life on every turn, there's nothing. So I took that pass, and I entered ghetto at the Iron Gate, Plac Żelaznej Bramy in Polish. At the entrance to ghetto, there were 3 policemen, Jewish, Polish, and German. Polish policemen had pistols. Jews didn't have pistols, they had just sticks, trenches, you know. And German, of course, he was. So at that time, somebody was talking to them. So from distance, I even didn't know where he was working exactly, straight. I show him this pass. He said, yeah, raus. So I enter ghetto. I enter ghetto, and I wasn't prepared what I saw. I saw people lying on the street, dead, dying. Girls were grabbing me, hoping that I had a piece of bread. I didn't have any. And then I saw Jewish police beating them. They seemed fairly well fed. I got furious, I got mad. At that time I was thinking, if this happened on our side, the Polish immigrant army finished them off. Today I am looking at a different point of view. They probably wanted to save their lives. And I know that Jewish, especially younger generation, but the old generation, they were lost. They were religious, they, you know, there was nothing. But young generation, they saw that they are going to finish everybody. So I was shaken, but at that time, for me, it was natural, you know. People killed, so more or less you got used to, but still, I never forget that when I was over there.
You had not realized how bad it was
I didn't. Everybody knew they were taking to Treblinka concentration camp, in Auschwitz concentration camp, and some other camps. They were also, inside Warsaw Ghetto, they were executing Poles afterwards, too. You know, you hear about that, you know that is bad, but you have to see it.
How long were you in the ghetto that time?
I was got for a few hours, only a few hours. And if I knew, I would take a piece of bread, but I didn't have. But you had thousands of people, thousands of them. What were you going to do? I saw movie Pianist. And I remember that overpass I was walking and so on, those people lying, this car putting bodies on this, I saw it. But what could you do? My brother was in concentration camp, my mother left in the field, he never buried my mother. My aunt died in concentration camp and so on, so the only thing, we were hoping that Russians were pushing Germans and Allies win the war and we'll be free. And then I went to see my father, south of Poland. He was chief of the police. At first, as I mentioned, it bothered me because now he was chief of police and during German occupation. And general opinion was that Polish police cooperating with Germans, you know, that was baloney. I went to see my father. He didn't know I was still in the Polish Immigrant Army. And there was a long village, few kilometers or few miles. There wooden houses, you know, farmers and so on. I went over there and that was just before Easter 1943. Of course, my father was glad to see me. I was still alive with family together and so on. My father got married for the second time. And came evening, and father said, oh, I have gone to the to police station. I said, why, Dad, where are you going? I don't sleep at home. I sleep at the police station. There was mostly wooden buildings, I mean farmhouses. But police station was brick building. In the window there was steel net, so nobody threw hand grenade. Behind entrance door, there was big brick wall. This is like a big, you know, fortification. Because in that area, there's a lot of bandits, Polish underground army. At that time, Russians were dropping parachutes, organized their underground army and so on. and only poor farmers who had to supply food for Germans, and the bandits came and took his cow or pig, and he's responsible to Germans. So quite often there was a reprisal, but there was a place when they had to bring farmers so much food, so many Indian. And quite often Polish underground army came to that place when they brought all the food and they confiscated and so on. And in meantime, partisans had to eat. There were some groups of Jews who survived, and they were going to farmer. And farmer was defending himself, and they were hungry. What can you do? So that's the situation.
We need to take a break.